Hi, I'm Taronish Pithawala, Geosoft's technical lead for geophysical modeling. In this presentation, you'll get a glimpse behind the scenes of the process of interpreting inversion results. We will not focus on any given technique or inversion method, but rather on the importance of scientific dialogue and iteration. As an illustrative example, I present a study of the Great Whale iron property in Quebec, Canada, using VOXI. The joint study with Joel Dubay of Dubay and Dessaulnier was conducted using freely available data from Quebec's Ministry of Natural Resources. There is a long-standing practice that geological, geochemical, and geophysical analysis be conducted separately by specialists. The results and individual interpretations are then brought together, and the task of reconciling them is complicated by the lack of a common dialogue. Nowhere is this dichotomy more evident than in the geological interpretation of geophysical inversion models. A common approach usually looks like this. Geophysical data is acquired, an inversion or two is run by the geophysicist, who then interprets some structure and may suggest targets for drilling. A report is then submitted to the geologist, who may either say, "This doesn't match the geology," or who may approve the target, only to find that there was nothing there. I've even been witness to exploration groups withholding geological data from geophysical contractors so that they could be certain the geophysical models weren't manipulated to resemble the geology. When the results came in, often they didn't match the known geology. Now, anyone familiar with inversion will expect this as a consequence of non-uniqueness. But to the uninitiated, it simply appeared that the geophysics was wrong or didn't work for the deposit type. The fallout was a deep-seated mistrust, a growing frustration, and an even more pronounced separation between the specialists. Working on the unified 3D Earth model of Great Whale was a joint effort between myself and my cohort, Joel Dubay. The process was iterative and revolved around discussion. Every time an inversion was run, we asked ourselves, what do we know for certain? What did we guess, based on what? What are the implications of our assumptions? And what are the alternatives, and how do we test them? Only then could we infer the structure and location of the magnetite iron formation from the inversion result. Inversion modeling is similar to interpolative modeling like wireframing. In both methods, the inferences we make and the resulting outcomes depend not only on the observed data, but on all the assumptions we made in creating the model. It is important to make the distinction between observed data and interpreted models. In the study of Great Whale, many of our assumptions had equally possible alternate realities. It was critical to our investigation that we could test each of them rapidly. Getting an inversion result in minutes instead of hours allowed us to test and validate over a dozen models. The unified Earth model is one where a common interpretation of the subsurface is mutually consistent with all available data, be it geophysical, geochemical, or geological. To facilitate this type of interpretation, it is important that all modeling is performed jointly in a multidisciplinary way. Inversion in general is not a new method, nor is it strictly limited to specialists in computer modeling. In the past, a geophysicist would look at contour maps or profiles of a geophysical survey and, using his expertise and experience, form a 3D picture in his mind, a model of the subsurface. This model would be shared with the exploration team and discussed. This was, in essence, an inversion. Since then, technology has advanced, but the role of inverse modeling is still to facilitate discussion and iterative interpretation between all members of the exploration team. Interpretation of the subsurface has progressed to a point where 3D is the standard view of the Earth. In order to incorporate the geophysical observations into the unified 3D Earth model, we needed a 3D representation of the rock properties, in this case, susceptibility. Using inversion, we were able to cross-validate a geological model built from surface mapping and shallow drill holes with the geophysical observations. If there was no way for us to reconcile the geophysical observations to the geological model, it indicated some invalid assumption, forcing us to revisit the geological model. Conversely, when initial geophysical inversions did not match the geological wireframe, we identified incorrect modeling parameters and tried again. This joint approach was better able to highlight potential targets for follow-up drilling The Great Whale iron deposit in Quebec is comprised of three Lake Superior type magnetite iron deposits. Of these, deposit A consists of several hundred feet of quartz magnetite banded iron formation lying within a greater sequence of pyroclastic and sedimentary rocks. Mineralization is almost entirely magnetite. The magnetite iron formation trends north-northwest and has an estimated magnetite content of 45 to 50%. The formation is also heavily folded and is essentially an anticline within a homoclinal sequence. The axial plane dips steeply to the east, and the fold axis plunge is nearly horizontal. 58 diamond drill holes were drilled in 1958 at an average dip of 45 degrees. Lithology and mineralization data for each hole is freely available from Quebec's Ministry of Natural Resources. Here, we see a section slice through a few drill holes. The map on top is a pixelated inset of the surface geology along the strike of the section map. The red bars along the drill hole traces indicate mineralized intersections with an average grade of 35% iron. We use Geosoft Oasis Montage wireframing tools to digitize the mineralized zone in 3D and create a 3D wireframe model. When designing the wireframe, we avoid making conjectures about how the iron formation is connected at depth or in areas of sparse drilling. In the presentation, all comparisons to ground truth are based on inferences made when creating the wireframe model and surficial geology map. In October 1998, a helicopter magnetic survey was conducted over deposit A. This data is also available from Quebec's Ministry of Natural Resources. The magnetic survey lines are spaced 200 meters apart, with the average sensor height being 48 meters above the terrain. The black outline is the region of mapped surface geology shown previously. The most fundamental assumption we make is that the lithology and mineralization indicative of the iron formation and used in the wireframe is also responsible for the magnetic signature observed. This is an important hypothesis that requires careful consideration. Additionally, we can postulate that the iron formation has induced magnetization only. This may not be the case and should be vetted through additional modeling, but it will serve as an initial hypothesis. Lastly, analog studies of similar iron formations indicate that an acceptable range of susceptibilities within the iron formation is between 0.8 and 2.2 SI, with an average of 1.7 SI. Non-uniqueness of the inverse problem is manifest in the effect auxiliary information has on the result. Quickly, we'll recap the process of inversion. First, data within the data space is observed, such as this gravity gradient grid here. A reference model in the model space is chosen, as is a starting model. The forward response is calculated from the starting model, and some distance norm is calculated to see how close the observed data is to the predicted data. Step changes are made to the model within the model space until a forward response that matches the observations is found. The resulting model, like models 1 and 2, will depend heavily on the auxiliary parameters input into the inversion. The choice of auxiliary parameters are based on the modeler's assumptions of putative structure and distribution, appropriate model discretization, error tolerance, and the effect of peripheral sources. These assumptions are in the geophysical domain, but they have counterparts in the geological domain if you consider structural mapping and lithology. Any interpretation of the model results must address the validity of these assumptions and their consistency within the unified Earth model. Over a dozen inversion models were run in the study of Great Whale. I will present four of these to illustrate the impact of assumptions in inversion and the benefit of iterative dialog regarding the geology and geophysics of the area. The default unconstrained susceptibility model is based on a smooth reference model. This is the piece of auxiliary information that hinges on the assumption that the geophysical property is smoothly distributed within the volume. In the case of the Great Whale deposit, this is a poor assumption, as we expect susceptibility to be confined to a compact, folded, banded iron formation. The model recovered from the initial inversion has both positive and negative susceptibilities. This is due to the fact that we did not place any upper or lower bounds on the inversion model. You'll note that the inversion result does match the overall trend of the geological model of the iron formation, shown in black, although it is not well defined. Additionally, the inversion result is not skewed by the chosen cell size, nor did any peripheral sources manifest in the extremities and padding cells of the model. Therefore, we can continue with our chosen model discretization and trend removal. In this image, we see a 1.7 SI isosurface of the model result in yellow. Recall that the 1.7 SI is the average susceptibility expected for the iron formation. Note the disagreement between the black wireframe and the geophysical model. Plausible alternatives are that the susceptibility distribution is compact, reflecting the structure of the iron formation. Furthermore, we can postulate that the iron formation has induced magnetization only and has a susceptibility greater than the sedimentary host rocks and the background we removed. Therefore, we can expect positive susceptibilities only. Since we expect the target iron formation to be compact in structure and the susceptibilities within the volume to be positive relative to the background, we enforce a lower bound of 0 SI and apply iterative reweighting inversion focusing, or IRI focusing, in Model 2. The result is a model that is consistent with the finite structure hypothesized for the iron formation and the assumption that the susceptibility within the model is positive only. The idea that magnetization is in the direction of the inducing field is only a guess in the case of Great Whale. The alternative is that the magnetization of the iron formation is not in the direction of Earth's magnetic field, but is rotated due to effects like demagnetization, anisotropy, or remnants. A thorough investigation of plausible Earth models, in this case, could also include models where the magnetization is not fixed in a particular direction. Magnetization vector inversion, or MVI, is a method offered within VOXI to allow for such modeling. In the scope of this presentation, we do not cover all possible models for many of the alternate assumptions we outline. If you would like more information on MVI, please visit our website at www.geosoft.com. In this image, we see the 1.7 SI isosurface of the inversion result in green. Note that with two small changes in the modeling parameters, based on the assumptions that I discussed with my colleague, we were able to find a geophysical model that agrees with the wireframe much more closely. However, Model 2 is inconsistent with two things. The iron formation has been mapped as a series of surface outcrops, and shallow drilling confirms that the iron formation lies near the surface. Model 2 does not place zones of high susceptibility near the surface, nor does it satisfy the assumption from analog studies that the susceptibility within the iron formation is less than or equal to 2.2 SI. These norms will be tested in the next inversion model. By introducing an upper bound of 2.2 SI and incorporating a shallow depth weighting, we see that the model is now closer to the surface, with a reduced depth extent. The general structure of the high susceptibility also matches the structural constructs deduced from the geology, an easterly dipping axial plane and a horizontal plunge axis. We see here that Model 3 is a slight improvement over Model 2. The shallow depth weighting constraint is based on the observed outcrop and drilling results. However, the constraint precludes any verticality in the structure of the iron formation and assumes that the depth weighting is laterally uniform across the volume. The alternative is that the iron formation outcrops and extends to depth in some places. With our wireframe model, we can improve the result by forcing the inversion to place high susceptibilities near the surface where we have mapped the iron formation, while allowing for deeper regions if required. In the final presented model, we incorporate our wireframe volume as the best approximation of the known structure. To recap the Oasis montage workflow, a series of section maps were created using the drill hole logs. On each section, the structural interpretation was digitized. A 3D volume was then stitched together. Analog studies of similar iron formations in Quebec were used to create a parameter reference model for susceptibility using the VOXI constraint builder. The wireframe model is loaded, and within it we assign a value of 1.7 SI, the average susceptibility of mineralized zones in similar iron formations. A parameter weighting voxel is also created to assign confidence within the model space. We are fairly confident within the wireframe volume, but have limited knowledge further from the drilling. The assumptions made are implicit in each set of constraints we added. The wireframe model is based on our best structural approximation so far, but it could be wrong. The parameter reference model is based on analog studies, but those could be wrong as well. And finally, our confidence in the reference model could be over or underestimated. The result is a model that matches the wireframe structure and outcrop pattern. It is compact and extends to depth in some places. It should be noted that all four models satisfied the observed geophysical data within 5% of its standard deviation. However, each model had a different 3D distribution of the susceptibility. Some were more consistent with our understanding of the geology than others. Moreover, we saw that the depth extent in all four models was so easily affected by the auxiliary parameters that we cannot deduce with any confidence the depth extent of the iron formation using magnetic inversion alone. Additional data, such as gravity and borehole susceptibility observations, could help with continued modeling. Model 4, while seemingly the most constrained, is still based on the assumptions that went into creating the wireframe model. As testament to the usefulness of inversion, note that the similarities between models which were not constrained by wireframe and Model 4, which was constrained by the geological wireframe, all support the accuracy of the near-surface interpretation from drilling. In this sense, the geological model was used to improve the inversion result, and the inversion models were used to validate the geological interpretation and shed light on regions not explored by drilling. The inversion results depend on the assumptions we made when creating the constraints for this model. As new information is available, it should be incorporated into additional inversions, continually evolving the unified 3D Earth model in an effort to reconcile all available data. In summation, my colleague Joel Dubé and I gathered freely available geological, geochemical, and geophysical data and started with what we knew for certain. We identified what assumptions we felt comfortable making and thought about their impact on the inversion result. We validated those assumptions through a series of models which we were able to rapidly test and interpret. The ability to integrate data within one platform, Oasis Montage, facilitated scientific dialogue between Joel and I and was crucial to an effective interpretation. We learned that validating geological and geophysical assumptions used in the inversion is as much a part of an interpretation as inferring structure or picking drill targets. And when the geology, geochemistry, and geophysics didn't align within a unified 3D Earth model, we took it as an opportunity to review and discuss our ideas of the subsurface together. All models from all available data must be mutually consistent with one another. No single model, geological or geophysical, can be considered correct if it doesn't align with other observations. I would like to thank my collaborator, Joel Dubé, and the Quebec Ministry of Natural Resources for providing the data. Thank you for watching this presentation. If you have any questions or comments, email us at explore@geosoft.com or visit our website, www.geosoft.com, for more information about VOXI and Oasis Montage.